Stop me now. Feel something. Something is keep his child. You can't hide it. When I looked in her eyes, they were blue.
Keeps me running, running scared. Thank you.
Daddy, who's been wearing Miranda's clothes?
Beyond me, like before. Oh, Better have not been to Oxford. food the foul. This is my bunk with two sheets.
Told the bird.
Pay the private eye.
Oswald.
Oswald.
20th century dies.
Thank you.
function as beauty. Dead. Oh.
problems. Oh, 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 oh. I never touch you.
And you all want silver screen, can't tell them apart. us in the hot sun. The mantle of dealer's hands, the fisting of life to the music outside, the music outside.
Thank you. history, put on their bloody robes. And the word is out, the hunted ones is out there on his own. And you'll know what may be the last time.
This passing time. In his eyes, subs and police tattoos, streaking cathedral smiles. They say,
Bye. Well, we are live at Skydome, as you can probably surmise from the background noise, and a couple of people are with us now. Trent Reznor is here, Kevin McMahon, Prick. Nice to see you guys. Thanks a lot for coming. We really appreciate it.
Hello. Thanks.
And I got to start with you, Trent. There was kind of an interesting quote that I read. It goes back a ways to March 94, I think it was, in Musician Magazine, and you were talking about, you know, meeting different people and not wanting to meet idols to keep them at sort of a safe distance. And you said at that time that, you know, you were sort of worried about meeting Bowie because then he might not be the cool guy that he was in your head.
No, I remember saying that. I was wondering if anyone's going to bring that up. But he has gone on to be the super nice, cool guy, and just a joy to work with, and have not been let down in any level with him.
Does it seem like there's sort of a karma coming full circle in a way? Because you also said in that article that you and Flood, at the time of recording Downward Spiral, were listening to a lot of, you know, Bowie, like Low and Lodger era Bowie, and now here you are in this sort of position. It's kind of an interesting way things have come around.
Yeah, it's been real flattering for us. I mean, when he asked us to do this, touring was not what I wanted to really do at that time, but then I thought this could be a way that I could feel better about Nine Inch Nails, and I was real tired of touring. We finished the last time, so we redid everything, and just to be standing on stage next to him and seeing that, you know, I was looking over at Robin, our guitar player, and he's seeing me with Bowie in the background and singing one of our songs, and it's like, this is crazy. No, this is great. So,
it's amazing.
Yeah.
To an extent, certainly having Prick on the bill, and this was something that was sort of intimated the last time you were in Toronto, I guess on a promotional tour, but it does seem to tip the scales a little bit in terms of who the audience might be. Was there any concern about that the audience might be so into Nine Inch Nails and not be quite as open-minded to Bowie material, or has that been an issue at all?
It's been something that, you know, I thought about and considered, and when the idea came up, there was a degree of concern that my fans would be open-minded enough to be in front of something that's maybe not what they're listening to all the time. And I can't assume that everyone that listens to Nine Inch Nails also shares my affection for David Bowie. But we've orchestrated the show in such a way, I think, that it makes sense in a not real obvious way. You might not think if you just heard the bill. With the addition of Prick, aside from my own personal interest in promoting friends and the project I worked on, I thought the music, Kevin's music, always kind of had some influences from both camps. Not that it's split down the middle, but it made sense in another way, too. So.
And I'm sure it's a spectacular show. I mean, the sound check sounded pretty great. So, yeah. So just on another sort of level, I have to ask you something. I've been reading a lot about Interscope Records, and there's been some question about its future, and it's been coming under an awful lot of attack on the American right wing and this whole sort of Bob Dole era stuff. Can you shed any light on what's going on with that and what the future of, you know, Nine Inch Nails Records or other artists signed to that label might be?
I have no fear about what's going to happen with Interscope. I mean, they're leaving the Time Warner family, and if Time Warner's not a conglomerate that can support freedom of speech, then it's a place I'd rather not be anyway. And everyone at Interscope feels the same way. And Bob Dole's just playing politics and latching on anything he can to, you know, get back to this dated idea of American values and trying to appeal to conservative movement in America right now, which I have no care or concern anything else with, and they can't really do anything about it. They've created a problem, what could have been looked at as a problem with Interscope, but it's a complex situation. It has a lot to do with Time Warner's vested interest in the cable industry, which is relative to bills that go through in the future of that. So I just want to make music, and I don't want people messing with me. So.
Understood. If you're just joining us, we're speaking with Trent Reznor. Kevin McMahon is also here, and we are live from Skydome. And obviously, a pressing question for a lot of people is when we might expect another album from you. I mean, I'm sure you must be, on one hand, inundated with so many requests of people who want to work with you or maybe have you mix something for them or produce something for them, and you must have to sort of weigh that into the larger priorities of what you want to do right now.
There's lots of things I'd like to do. I'm not really keen on doing remixes anymore. I'd like to produce. I just produced a Marilyn Manson record that's coming out soon. And the idea of collaboration, I'm going to incorporate a lot on the new Nine Inch Nails stuff. But I don't really want to climb into a hole and do another record for another, look at it as a year-long project thing. So I'm not sure if the next thing I'm going to do is going to be direct Nine Inch Nails or something outside the perimeter of that could be fun for me as an artist to do. we just did a live record and some things on the side that we were trying to get together to get out before this tour, and I just took a step back and thought it wasn't really up to par, so it's somewhere on the back burner. There may be something come out, but I'm not sure what it's going to be. And it wasn't good enough to be great, so I'm not going to put it out. So.
And I'm sure in terms of new material, it must be necessary for you to do some serious woodshedding and sort of get all your thoughts together and also try to find a new vocabulary of sounds that you want to explore on any record, right?
Yeah, I mean, I think I've done what I've done to the point where it's time to reevaluate. You know, when I'm touring, I don't have a lot of time to sit back and contemplate new directions that much. It's mostly you don't have a lot of time to yourself, so I need some time just to get my head together and figure out what's going to happen.
Excellent. And Kevin, while you're here, you've been kind of quiet, but we'd like to get a few words. Has it been going down all right for you? Have the crowd's been fairly receptive? Is it what you expected it would be?
Hey, how's it going? Yeah, it's a little better than I expected it to be. The crowds are getting in there sooner, and they seem to be paying more attention than I think they would normally at a opening band for three bill, especially with Trent's band and Bowie. I think that audience is pretty hardcore into each individual act, and it's kind of good that they pay attention at all. So we've been successful in entertaining them to the point where they're not throwing shit at us.
And backstage, have there been like pranks and initiation rites or any stuff like that that you can actually talk about?
Nothing I could talk about. We're just trying to get by here, you know?
Well, we're just at the point where we're getting our heads above water. And it's been a difficult, from a production standpoint, getting the thing together, because we orchestrated the show so they flow into each other with the same lights and production, and it makes sense that way too. And it wasn't until the last show we just played, which would be the third show, that, or was it the second show? It doesn't matter. It's finally starting to feel comfortable on stage, and I'm not worried about a light falling off and killing somebody in the band, those sort of things.
That would be good, you know. I'd really want to work that bit out myself as well. We are speaking with Trent Reznor and Kevin McMahon, and I guess you guys should get backstage pretty soon, unless you feel, you know, the overwhelming need to hang, but...
I'd sort of like to hang out here for a little bit.
Well, why don't we play some music? If you don't come back, it was great to see you. And if you do, you know, we'll speak more. Here's music from Nine Inch Nails on 102.1 The Edge.
Now! make you feel better. The pigs have won tonight. They can all sleep soundly, and everything is alright.
102.1 The Edge Music from Nine Inch Nails performing tonight at the Skydome with David Bowie, and our thanks to Trent and also to Kevin for coming by and chatting with us. 102.1 The Edge, that is brand new music from David Bowie, the first single from the forthcoming album called Outside. We are live at Skydome, and hey, David Bowie.
Hi, Kim, how are you?
It is such a thrill to be sitting here with you.
It's a thrill to be seen.
Well, thanks for coming by.
Well, my pleasure.
Uh-oh, cigarette. We were just talking about Nine Inch Nails, and you were saying you're about four shows in, and it's still in sort of the honeymoon stage, which is nice. But is it having any sort of impact on the performance that you're doing? I mean, following a group that's that intense and...
No, I'm just doing what I usually do. I mean, nothing's changed. The condition I give myself is to, because I like the material that I'm working with on this tour, is just to literally go on and really enjoy myself. And if I enjoy myself, then hopefully that translates out to the crowd.
And has that been the case so far? People have been...
Well, the most extraordinary thing is that my show is about an hour and a half long. And to see what is primarily a Nails audience kind of having to come to terms with listening to songs, none of which they've ever heard before in their lives, for an hour and a half is quite something. I mean, it's been just amazing. I mean, I've got to hand Trent, he's got a very intelligent audience.
But it does seem to be coming full circle. I was reading over an old interview that Trent Reznor had done with Musician Magazine in early 94, and he was talking about when he and Flood were doing the sessions for Downward Spiral, how he was listening to, you know, Heroes and Lodger and Low, and it came into a certain mindset. So there does seem to be kind of a full circle thing happening in a way. Because
I'm terribly pleased about that. I mean, when he told me some of the favorite songs of mine that are his, I mean, it was really quite surprising. He goes back a long way.
Incredible. Well, it looks like it's going to be a fantastic show, and certainly one of the interesting things about Outside is the premise of it. I mean, it has such a complex premise based on this diary that you've written, and so obviously, since people in the crowd won't have had a chance to,
Your lips look great. I'm kind of reading them here.
But obviously, since people haven't heard the record, they're going to have to be, I mean, pretty much...
Yeah, I know. I mean, it's, you know, that's something else I've got going for myself, you know, is to play an album that's not even released yet.
Unusual timing, but hey.
Well, why not?
Harkens back to your innovation once again, I think.
It's the time of my life. I'm really having the time of my life.
To an extent, you've been quoted as saying that you're trying to, in some way, document the end of the millennium and how things are changing and getting us up to this sort of turn.
Not only with the album, I think the act of doing this tour with the band that I've chosen to work with also has a sense of atmosphere of the times. It's the idea of what happens to an old rocker and what happens with a young band. So combine those two in a tour situation, I think, is also diary-esque in its own way.
Do you see a sense... What?
This is becoming like a Python thing.
No, it's not. Oh, with the sound. Maybe try the...
I'm reading well. I can read your lips.
But do you see, in a sense, that maybe Outside and any subsequent works are almost functioning as a kind of time capsule?
I didn't hear a word of that. I'm going to have to put my cans on. Hold on.
If you're just joining us, by the way, we're speaking with David Bowie. We are live at Skydome.
Oh, yeah, that's cool.
Better?
That's, wow, high tech.
And we're just wrapping up. But I was asking you if you see it as sort of a musical time capsule in a way.
The album series definitely will be. I mean, hopefully Brian and I will execute some kind of musical diary. And the touring situation itself, I'm picking some really interesting artists to work with throughout the world, wherever I'm doing the tour. And I hope in some way to be able to document that as well. Hopefully we'll be filming some of these things as well.
For video release, for art house release?
My attitude is film and tape everything and then wonder what you do with it afterwards.
Just two quick things, and then we'll let you go. First of all, has Eno contacted you, or have you contacted him about doing a follow-up to Outside?
Oh, yeah. We're going to just keep working. Yeah.
Amazing.
Yeah.
And one final thing, the video for Heart's Filthy Lesson, incredible, incredible thing.
Samuel Bayer is responsible for that, and he's a fantastic director. I'm so pleased that I chose to work with him. Wow. He's also doing the next video as well.
Excellent. David Bowie, thank you so much. It was a pleasure.
It's a pleasure.